The Wheel of the Year and A Curiosity of Pie Wackets, created, directed, and presented by Reverend Dr. Dickie Joe Mullen. In this video, Dr. Mullen looks at the Wheel of the Year, which comes from Earth religions over many centuries, and talks about pie wackets, which were a litter of kittens born in her backyard. At the end of the video, I will provide a slide to give you information as to where you might purchase the Curiosity of Pie Wackets chap book.
This is astrologer and paranormal investigator Reverend Dr. Dickie Joe Mullen coming to you from downtown Orlando, Florida, with a look at the Wheel of the Year, an alternative zodiac. Since earliest times, people have looked at the heavens above, related them to Earth below, and created different systems of calendars and astrology to help us orient ourselves and understand the world around us better. The Oriental Zodiac is one of these. There's a Native American Indian Zodiac and an Aztec calendar. There's also the Wheel of the Year, which has a link with Stonehenge, the giant astrological stone computer in England, and other stone circles throughout ancient Europe. The Wheel of the Year is a seasonal calendar, and it's divided into 8 different segments. It kind of reflects the Buddhist wheel with the 8 segments. And they begin with the 4 seasons and then halfway points between each season. It all starts with the first day of spring. Back in 1752, if Benjamin Franklin was going to wish you Happy New Year, he would have wished it near the spring equinox to you. And then after that, the calendar changed to what we call the New Style calendar, and New Year's Day became the New Year. But it wasn't that long ago that a version of the Wheel of the Year was used by everybody, and it started with the agricultural year being the first day of spring. Easter, or Ostara, is how we see that time of the year, which is when day and night are most equal, called the spring equinox. The second phase of the Wheel of the Year is May Day, or Beltane. Beltane comes from the word Belinus, which means fire, and it represents the fiery activity and growth of spring. May has a lot to do with the fertility of the world around us, and Mary Begots were names given to children that were conceived at May Day fertility festivals long ago. Flowered baskets delivered secretly are a part of May Day traditions, and a maypole with ribbons around it wound by dancers suggests the idea of brightness, fertility, and social interaction. The next of the festivals is Midsummer's Day. Midsummer is the longest day of the year, and it's also the summer solstice. That's when we have the longest day and the shortest night. It represents the height of the growing season. It has a very strong quality of brightness, expression. Midsummer day fairs in early modern Europe were ways of marking Midsummer's Day. The next festival is Lunasad, or Lammas, and it's an early harvest. It's August 1st, and it represents when the first fruits and the first vegetables come in, when we begin to see the results of the seeds that were sown back on the first day of spring. And it's a time of revelry, appreciation, and gratitude. And it has a tie with Lu, the sun god, and sometimes there's a song sung to represent the darkening of the light and the first stirrings of autumn. This is the death of Lu, the sun king. Why, oh why must you die? And then moving forward, we have the autumn equinox, sometimes called Mabon or Mayborn, and that's when day and night are nearly equal again. It's the first day of autumn, and that represents the idea of balancing what's been done so far in the year, looking ahead to the autumn, and preparing for the darkening of the light further. And the greatest change in temperature in the northern hemisphere will come between Mabon and the end of the year, jumping ahead to Yule. After Mabon, there's Halloween, or Samhain, which means summer's end, October 31st. That represents the beginning of the time of death, the fallow, quiet period, honoring the afterlife, things that are dying, the falling leaves, the plants that are seasonal dying back. It's a time when the veil to the other side is thinnest, and ancestors and communicating with and honoring ancestors, our background and heritage, thoughts turn to origins and the deeper meaning of life. After Samhain, or Midsummer's Day, the first day of autumn, the autumnal equinox, Yuletide is coming up. That's the winter solstice. That's the longest night and shortest day of the year, around December 21st. And Yule represents the word wheel. It represents the turning of the wheel. A Yule log was often burned to draw in the light. This correlates with our Christmas holiday season, and it's a time to brighten up with hope the dark, cold winter, and all of the winter festivals tie in with Yule. Finally, there's Imbolc, or Candlemas. That's February 2nd. That's when winter is beginning to wane. Candles are lit to brighten the dark winter days and welcome in the first tiny possible flowers or buds swelling in the springtime. And often images are made of a bride. It can be called a bride's festival, or a corn husk doll to represent what's been harvested, leading to a new rebirth or renewal. During one year, I had a direct experience with the wheel of a year, the year, when I discovered under my art studio here in Orlando, right on the first day of spring, a litter of kittens. And they were born all black, except for one black and white one, of a very feral mother cat, whom I called Lilith. And I nicknamed the kittens Piewackets. Piewackets are magical little spirits. The title goes back to the 1600s when the infamous witch finder, Matthew Hopkins, coined it to represent mischievous little spirits. And that certainly described these kittens who were born on the first day of spring. By the time it came to be May Day, their eyes had turned bright blue, and they were out wandering around, and I was very concerned because there was a terrible cat fight one night, one like you've never heard before, and I thought, oh, it's a good time to try to find them some homes. They were eating and drinking, and they were about that time 6 weeks old. Well, there was an adventure that went through the entire wheel of the year. All of the different people who helped the kittens, who were interested in them. One was born blind. I named her Cecilia, which represents blind one. And we managed through Facebook to raise some funds to have her eyes removed. And she went into rehab and found a seeing eye friend to help her. And a lovely family adopted them and gave her the name of Lucy, which means light, which I thought was interesting. And I wrote a chat book. Chat books are a form of book that appeared in early modern Europe, the 1790s or so. They were popular. They're less than 40 pages. They're usually a folded sheet of paper with possibly a few poems, a ballad, drawings, or woodcuts on them. And they were circulated by chapmen, salesmen, if you call someone a chap. It's kind of a popular, friendly guy, as a salesman has to be. And I named the book A Curiosity of Piewackets. It's available as an order for Templeton's White Cat Appreciation Foundation. Templeton had a very hard year. He's my white cat, some of you have met. And he very much was chagrined when the little pie wackets took over his life for a while and moved in. And the worst day of the year for Templeton is August the 17th. That's Black Cat Appreciation Day. And at that time, he decided to encourage me to write down his story, all the terrible things he's gone through, and to establish White Cat Appreciation Month. He wants a whole month. It's the month of April when he was born, on April 15th. And the Curiosity of Piwackets chapbook is available by order. And the money goes to Templeton for his White Cat Charitable Appreciation. And if you are interested, you can contact me by sending an email to skymaiden, one word, at Juno, JUNO.com. This is Dickie Jo Mullen wishing you a bright and happy Wheel of the Year. And just to kind of go over the wheel, the first day of spring is the first day of Aries. The first day of summer, Midsummer's Day, is June 21st, 22nd. The date varies according to the year. First day of Cancer. The sign of Libra begins with Mawbone or the autumn equinox around September 22nd, 23rd. Yuletide is winter, and that's the first day of Capricorn, December 21st or 22nd. It varies according to the year. The zodiac wheel and the wheel of the year, like all wheels, has 360 degrees, and we have 365 days in the year. And so there's a little bit of variance from year to year. And then the middle holidays are halfway between. May Day is between the first day of spring and the first day of summer. Lammas or Lunasad is August 1st, and that is between the first day of summer and the autumn equinox. Halloween or All Hallows or Samhain is going to be October 31st. That's the midpoint between autumn and winter. And then Candlemas is on or about February 2nd. And that's going to be the day that is the ending of the winter season, right before we come back to the beginning of a new wheel, when the agricultural year, the year of growth, the yearly rising of buds and falling of leaves, begins a whole new cycle.
After hearing the wonderful story of the Piwackets, Dr. Mullen is developing a number of chap books, CHAPBOOKS, and in order to order one of the books, she's provided here her email address. If you would like to email her, she will arrange to have you receive one of the chap books in the mail for a very minimal fee. We hope you've enjoyed the video and this experience of the Wheel of the Year and the Curiosity of Piwackets.